Hi, I'm Les Szarka. I'm here today with Alex Szarka. Welcome to Money Talks. And as always, if you enjoy these, hit that subscribe button, hit the share button. We always appreciate that. So we decided we wanted to get together today and talk about just what's going on in the markets and the economy. There's been a lot of changes going on just more recently.
A lot of volatile days in the market.
A lot of volatile days. And a lot of the things that we had talked about over the last couple months, it looks like maybe now we're getting closer and closer to that. And so what we mean by that is, you know, we've seen the deterioration in the economy coming on for a while now, but it seems like the stock market has just totally ignored it. Now, all of a sudden, with the volatility that you just mentioned, maybe now we're starting to see it coming to fruition where the market's actually paying attention to what's going on. So what we want to do is just kind of share with you what we've been looking at, you know, our thoughts and what we think is coming up in the near future. So
start with the economy first.
Yeah, let's start with the economy then.
Okay.
So what's going on there?
Well, number one issue in the economy, and it has been for a while, inflation.
Yeah.
So the big news with that is the fact that the last 4 months, inflation has actually ticked up. And that's been the fear for a while now, is that they have gotten inflation down from 9% to 3 point something. But would we have, you know, like a 1970s type reemergence of that?
Right.
Now, I don't think it's going to be that bad, but we have seen it the last 4 months.
Well, that's why the Fed has been so, you know, adamant about making sure that they're not cutting interest rates too soon, because that it potentially could ignite inflation back up to those levels. So,
or the fear of cutting rates. So there has been the markets have been anticipating there would be multiple rate cuts by the end of the year.
Right.
And at this point, because the inflation actually been ticking up a little bit, that's softened quite a bit.
Yeah, because if you remember back in January, I believe, the market was predicting, the market being the stock market, has been predicting 6 cuts,
right,
which would have equated to roughly about 1.5 percentage point drop in the interest rates. You know, back then, if you recall, I mean, we were saying that's ludicrous.
Yeah,
we've always been
in camp that would be.
Yeah, we were back then. I think we were predicting like 3. I think half of it, and now we're at the point now where we're in the 1 to none.
1 to none
camp. You know, where we might see one, and that might be just a token reduction that the Fed does for us.
Yeah, so that's inflation. We'll see what happens there, but also, you know, what does that do with interest rates? That's the other big one. So you want to talk about interest rates?
Well, again, we talked about a second ago, just, you know, we don't think really that the short-term interest rates are going to be coming down.
Right.
The Fed is kind of in this dilemma right now where they normally use interest rate reductions to stimulate the economy. Okay, so if you're going into a recession or if you're in a recession, the Fed drops interest rates to try to pull us out of a recession. The last thing the economy needs right now is any type of stimulation. I mean, the economy itself is growing. Now, we'll talk a little bit about
we'll go into a little bit more details about that.
You know, what's coming up maybe in the next few months. But right now, the last thing the market needs is more stimulation.
Right.
And so that's why we don't think interest rates are going to be coming down. I know we've been getting, I'm sure you've been getting questions too from clients saying, you know, well, are my CD rates going to be coming down, or money
treasury
market
rates.
Treasury rates? And we don't think short term that they're going to be coming down.
So higher for longer.
Higher for longer, which again is not going to make the stock market happy.
Right.
And I think the stock market is kind of a little bit delusional in the sense that they've been pricing in this big reduction in interest rates, which, like I said, I don't think is going to happen.
Yeah, if they do an interest rate cut, I think it'd be a cosmetic one, maybe one by the end of the year, if that.
And it also may be for political reasons.
Yeah, because it is an election year.
Yeah.
And that's actually not unusual if that happens during an election year.
Yeah. And they're not supposed to be political, but I can only imagine the amount of pressure that they're under right now to cut interest rates.
Right.
You know, to try to make the economy seem a little bit better than what it actually is. So with that, you know, let's kind of dovetail into on the economy side of it, where we're starting to see some real breaks in terms of, you know, the unemployment, consumer sentiment, small business sentiment. You want to start with the consumer side?
We'll start with the employment.
Okay.
Because there's been a lot of misconceptions behind that. That if you look at, because that's one thing they keep touting, is the unemployment numbers are still looking very, very strong. But, and there's a big but attached to that, if you break it down and you look at the unemployment numbers, most of the, or I should say jobs numbers, most of the jobs that they are adding on to the economy, the vast, vast majority of them are part-time jobs. They're not full-time jobs. So it's people getting multiple part-time jobs.
They're getting second and third jobs to try to make ends meet.
Right. So when you hear that on the media that they're adding all these jobs onto into the economy, the vast majority of them are part-time jobs. Right. And the vast majority of them are government jobs as well, right. Government and healthcare.
Is and the reason that's significant, by the way, is that when private sector creates a job, that's a plus to the economy. So now this person is spending money into the economy, they're paying taxes, et cetera. When you create a government job, that means that the rest of the taxpayers have to pay for that job. So it doesn't have nearly the effect, positive effect on the economy as if it's the private sector that's adding it. So we're starting to see, we're seeing that, you know, some of these numbers are being inflated by just adding government jobs to make it look better. And then the other point, as we were talking about this earlier, is that now, 12 out of the last 13 months that they've given out the jobs numbers, they've been revised downward the following month.
Yeah, so they'll put out a great jobs, you know, gangbuster jobs number, and then quietly about, what, maybe a week or two later, they'll revise it down.
Right.
And this has literally happened 12 out of the last, almost 12 out of the last 13 months.
Right, and they've overestimated job creation by, I think it's like 1.4 or 1.6 million jobs just in the last 12 months.
Right.
So again, it's hard to make some, you know, sometimes these longer term bets in terms of the market when you don't believe the data that you're actually seeing. It's kind of like if, you know, if the doctor says you have high blood pressure, so you buy a blood pressure cuff, and the problem is that it's defective. You know, so I'm getting the number, but I don't necessarily believe that it's an accurate number. So what good is it? Why are you even actually doing it?
Right.
And that's kind of where we're sitting today, not just with the jobs numbers, but I look at GDP and all the others.
Inflation numbers, frankly.
The real numbers that you can, you know, like come, like the consumer sentiment number, which is basically, you know, how positive is the consumer, you know, that comes out of the private sector. That's the University of Michigan does that. That's, you know, again, near an all-time low.
The PPI, inflation numbers.
Inflation numbers.
Manufacturers.
Again, those are more, I mean, those can be dummied up, frankly, you know, to, you know, lack of a better term.
Yeah.
The small business sentiment is another one that's concerning to us. That's at nearing an all-time low. The reason that's important is that, you know, roughly two-thirds of all job creation is from small businesses. So if small businesses are pessimistic, they're not going to be hiring. As a matter of fact, they might be looking at, you know, if things get any worse, who are we going to be laying off?
Mm-hmm.
You know, so those are all signs right now in the real world. And that's why there's a lot of times there's a big disconnect between Main Street and Wall Street. And I think that's what we've seen over the last, especially over the last 12 months, where Main Street is already, you know, way ahead of the curve saying, yeah, there's some problems out here.
Right.
Wall Street has just been in denial mode, you know, and
Main
the market
Street,
just kept moving up.
Main Street-wise, I mean, people have been feeling the inflation issue for the last few years pretty heavily. Because again, we've talked about this a few times, inflation is compounding. So if inflation was 9% last year, now it's 3% this year, it's technically 12%.
Right.
So people are very much feeling that in their pocket.
And you look at the last 3 years, I mean, you're looking at especially things that affect the average person, like, you know, buying food, putting gas in your car, utilities, taxes, insurance, those are up 24%. You know, so if you look at that, you know, if you look at a trend line where if I'm in retirement and all of a sudden, you know, my expenses are going up, you know, 2-3%, now all of a sudden it goes up 24% over a shorter period of time, that's sticking, which means that those expenses are going to still be there 5, 6, 7, you know, 10 years down the line. And that's why, you know, inflation is so insidious. I mean, it's one of those, you know, the unseen taxes, if you will, that we as consumers pay for when the government just spends too much money, which is kind of the boat that we're in right now.
Yeah. So we did, we talked about Main Street with the economy. Let's talk about Wall Street on
right.
the market side. So stock market wise, so far year to date, we have been seeing a few volatile days the last week or so because of the inflation numbers coming out, but still year to date, it's still going strong. S&P's up, actually S&P and NASDAQ are both up about 8% year to date, which interesting enough, the Dow 30 is actually only up about 1%. So there's still, again, like last year, there's a huge difference between performance wise between the S&P, the NASDAQ and the Dow.
Because, so why is that?
Because the S&P and the NASDAQ are heavily dominated by those big seven, those Magnificent Seven stocks. Now, we are seeing cracks in
and those are what, the more high
tech? Facebook, Amazon.
No, but I mean, those are more high tech.
Well, the high tech and AI.
AI, yeah.
So those are the Amazon, Apple, Facebook, Microsoft, Google, NVIDIA, Tesla.
Yeah. I'm impressed you remembered all seven.
Yeah, it's the Fat Man acronym. That's how I remember it. But we are starting to see cracks in that, though, with Apple and Tesla being down pretty significantly this year.
Right.
So we're starting to see cracks in that massive bubble we've been talking about for the last year and a half.
So it appears now that maybe Wall Street has finally come to the realization that the Main Street has, you know, already known for the last year or so, is that things aren't quite as rosy as what maybe like the media wants to portray, or what a lot of, you know, so what Wall Street wants to portray. Because obviously Wall Street's in the business of selling stocks.
Right.
You know, and so you kind of take it with a grain of salt what their predictions, at least we do, because if I'm a stock fund manager, the stock market always looks great. Because the second I come out and say, yeah, you know what, I think maybe the stock market's a little bit overpriced, guess what's going to happen? People sell off. Right. Well, that's going to affect my bottom line. So I'm always going to be, you know, sitting there promoting stocks. If all I have is a hammer, everything looks like a nail. And so consequently, we kind of discount what Wall Street says. I'm more concerned about what's actually happening on Main Street. The problem is sometimes there's this time lag where you can be wrong, and then you're finally, the reality hits and boom, you know, the market finally corrects. So I think it's inevitable that we're going to see a market correction. It's just a matter of when and how deep.
Right.
You know,
so
how long
far,
is it
our
last?
Crystal ball has not told us.
No, the crystal ball is definitely not. We need to change the batteries in that thing, I think.
So on stocks, I think we're still cautiously optimistic on stocks. You just have to be very strategic in terms of what stocks you're actually buying right now.
Okay,
it definitely would not be the big seven.
So let's segue. So what about bonds? Where are we?
So bonds right now, year to date, the Barclays Ag, which is the bond index, is actually still slightly negative for the year.
But, really?
Yeah, it's actually, believe it or not, most people don't realize that, but it is actually negative. But all in all, we are still pretty actually optimistic with bonds just based on where interest rates are. Because again, bonds are completely predicated on interest rates. And if the Federal Reserve is pretty much done raising rates, and even if they're not even going to cut rates by the end of the year, as long as they just don't raise rates this year, that would actually bode pretty well for the bond market.
Yeah, so at that point,
we're
just collecting the coupon, the interest rate that it pays. We're just not going to necessarily expect a big capital gains on it.
Yeah, you may not get as much growth as we may initially thought if they were cutting rates. But as long as they're sideways and they're not actually raising rates, I think the bond market will actually be pretty.
So
by
really,
the end of the year, it'll be pretty.
The question then comes down to is if we do hit a recession, then yeah, the Fed might be in a position where they have to drop interest rates. If that happens, that's then a positive for the bond market.
It would be a very big positive for the bond market.
So then you're picking up whatever the interest rate is plus some capital appreciation.
Exactly.
Okay.
So even though the Barclays Ag is slightly negative for the year, that doesn't mean the whole bond market, just like the stock market, there's different sectors of the stock market that could be performing very well, even though the index isn't doing great. Same thing with the bond market.
Okay.
So we are very optimistic on bonds right now.
So what about, we were looking at commodities, and then we're also looking at precious metals, because those have done, from what I understand, pretty well.
Yeah. So oil is up 20 something percent so far, just year to date.
Okay.
So first 4 months of the year, precious metals are having a phenomenal year. Gold is going gangbusters right now. So very optimistic.
That's up 18%?
About 18% right now.
Okay. So again, to what that means.
Gold. You're talking about gold.
Gold,
right.
So what that means to you, though, is that on one hand, if you're buying gold, or if you're buying, let's say, oil contracts, that's great news. The bad news is if you're filling your car up, that's bad news, because obviously, we've seen gas prices. I think we bottomed out a few months ago. I think I bought gas for like $3.09. Mm-hmm. It was close to hitting like $3, and we're back up to what, $3.49, $3.59, something like that, which again then feeds into inflation.
Right.
So what's good for the commodities market isn't necessarily good for the consumer, because that means that the underlying price of goods is actually moving up, which then is going to potentially feed inflation.
Bad for Main Street, good for Wall Street.
Exactly.
So that's about it, though, on the market side.
Okay. What's this mean to you? Well, from a Main Street perspective, what I would be cautioning for folks at this point is I would just be careful adding any new debt, especially things like credit card debt. We're looking at the consumer at all-time high credit card debt. Watch
over
your purchases.
$1 trillion.
Yeah, $1 trillion. There's needs and wants. Focus on the needs. Maybe the wants can wait a little bit. But I would just be cautious at this point over the next few months, mainly because we're going to start seeing unemployment clicking up.
On the stock market side, regarding your investments in terms of stocks, if you do have stocks, you may want to play a little bit more defensively. If you're higher in stocks, maybe take some profits off the table since it was a very good year last year. Maybe transition that some over to some bonds, because we are pretty optimistic on bonds this year. As long as the rates aren't moving up, I think bonds are going to have a good year. So maybe just transition some of those stocks over there instead. Basically de-risk your portfolio.
Okay, I think that's good. I would agree with that. I think that's good advice. place. So overall, again, the world's not ending, but at the same time, there are certain periods of times where we just want to be a little bit more cautious. I think that's kind of where we are now. So thank you very much for tuning in, and then we'll see you next time.